Hi, let me give you a little bit of a review for your second exam, okay? So, for your exam on Tuesday, you would need to know, of course, radian and degree measure, okay? So, for instance, you should be able to compare, let's say, and we can just draw the unit circle, okay? It doesn't have to be unit circle. But, let's say I want you to look for 5 radians versus 5 degrees, okay? So you should be able to figure out where these angles are, central angles are. So 5 degrees, well, you know this is 90 degrees, this is 0 degrees, so you know that 5 degrees has to be pretty small, right? Okay, so we can stop there and say, okay, that's my 5 degree angle, all right? On the other hand, 5 radians, well, we already saw in class, right, that this is 1.57 radians, this is 3.14 radians, 4.71 radians, 6.28 radians, okay? So rather than counting the radius 5 times around the unit circle, then you can just look here and 5 radians is between 4.71 and 6.28, okay? So then I might ask you for the quadrant. So this terminal side of 5 radian angle ends in quadrant 3, okay? No, not quadrant 3. What's that? Quadrant 4, sorry, okay? It's between 4.71 and 6.28, so it's in quadrant 4. And the 5 degree angle, the terminal side ends in quadrant 1, okay? So based on this, you should be able to answer, like, a lot of questions, like what is the sine of the sign of cosine or tangent or whatever, depending on the quadrant, okay? Just a quick review. Also, if the angle is given as negative, then of course you have to measure it in the clockwise direction, okay? So if this had been negative 5 radians and negative 5 degrees, okay? So negative 5 degrees will be down here. That's your negative 5 degrees, okay? And negative 5 radians will be, now this is going to be negative 4.71 and this is negative 6.28. So now negative 5 radians will be here, okay? In quadrant 1. So if we switch it, that becomes quadrant 1 and this becomes quadrant 4. So let me just make sure you see that, okay? So that's how you find your radians and degree measures, and just be ready to answer whatever questions, and a lot of it just really depends on knowing where the quadrant of your angles, the terminal side, will lie, okay? Right. Other important thing you need to know for your test is the unit circle and all these special values, okay? So I put here the quadrantal points, okay, where the terminal point on the for the quadrantal angles or arcs, okay? So this is for the 0 radian angular arc or the 2 pi radian angular arc, okay, on the unit circle. And this is for pi over 2. This is for pi, this is for 3 pi over 2. And of course, if you go in the negative direction, then it will just be the reverse. Negative pi over 2, negative pi, negative 3 pi over 2, negative 2 pi. And then the special values for pi over 6, which really corresponds to the 30 degree angle, right? For the pi over 4 radian measure of the angle or the arc, that corresponds to your 45 degree angle. And then this one is for your 60 degree angle. Okay, and we just need to know, we derived these already, okay? So, yeah, it's just memorize this so you don't have to derive all the time. This just these values that you need to know, okay? So for pi over 6, let me put it closer, I hope you can see. So yeah, so there pi over 6 is rad 3 over 2 and 1 half, so that's the x coordinate, the y coordinate. Pi over 4 is rad 2 over 2, rad 2 over 2 for both x and y. And for pi over 3, or your 60 degree angle, it's a half rad 3 over 2, okay? So if you're familiar with these, then it would be very easy for you to say, answer the question, what is the sine of 7 pi over 4, okay? So if you're looking for the sine of 7 pi over 4, 7 and 4 have nothing to do with each other. That means they're relatively prime. They don't have any common factors. So you know that this is a multiple of pi over 4. Okay, this is a multiple of pi over 4. It's just a matter of finding out where this multiple of pi over 4 is. So you know that the answer to this will have to involve rad 2 over 2, right? Okay, so how do you locate 7 pi over 4? change the mix, the improper fraction 7/4 into a mixed number. So that's 1 3/4 of a pi, right? Okay, of pi. So I told you before, so if you want to look for this, then pi is here, right? 1 pi is here. You want to add 3/4 of the pi, so then this is where you land. That is your 7 pi/4. It's in the fourth quadrant, so because we're in the fourth quadrant, sine has to be negative. So just using this, you can answer this type of a question, okay? So, or another way you could have looked for this is, you know, figure out that after 7 pi/4 is 8 pi/4. 8 pi/4 is 2 pi, so 2 pi minus pi/4, you're here, okay? So, but it's just counting where you are on the unit circle, all right? So if I want, let's say, the secant of, let's say, -11 pi/6, okay? -11 pi/6. So 11 and 6, you cannot cancel anything anymore. So you know that this is a multiple of pi/6. So you know that secant is the reciprocal of cosine, and you know it has something to do with the pi/6 thing. I mean, it has to be the same numerical value as this, okay? Let's see, square root of 3/2, when you take the reciprocal of that, is 2/√3. If you rationalize, so that's 2√3/3, right? Okay? Now you just have to figure out where you are on the unit circle for -11 pi/6. So again, let's look at our improper fraction. That's -1 5/6, right? Okay? Now you go the other way. So let's see, do I have... So let me do it here. So -1 pi, you land here, right? -5 pi/6, so therefore you go clockwise and you count pi/6 means you cut pi into 6 equal parts. So 5 pi/6 will be there, all right? So -11 pi/6 will be in the first quadrant and secant will have to be positive there, okay? The other way, of course, again, that you could have looked at this is after 11, you have 12. So 12/6 is 2, so that's -2 pi, right? And you take away a pi/6, or add a pi/6 to that, so you'll end in the first quadrant. So that's how you can use this. You don't have to memorize the entire circle, okay? So you just have to know these values, as well as the quadrantal values. So quadrantal values are going to be useful for, let's say, questions like, for instance, if I ask you, what is the tangent of 23 pi, okay? Tangent of 23 pi, then you see, well, where is 23 pi? Without having to count 23 times around, that's 1 pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi. We already generalized this, that because this is an odd integer, odd multiple of pi, right? That this is actually going to land here, right? On this side, on the left. So the coordinates are -1, 0, right? Okay. Tangent is sine over cosine, so that's going to be 0/-1. So tangent of 23 pi is 0, okay? Likewise, if let's say I wanted to look for instance, the cosecant of, let's say, 102 pi. Cosecant of 102 pi, 102 is an even integer, right? So this is an even multiple of pi. So we already observed that for even multiples of pi, we land here. Alright? So therefore, this is the 0.10. I want cosecant, so therefore I want the reciprocal of sine. Sine is the y-coordinate of the point. The y-coordinate is 0. So therefore, that's going to be 1/0, which is undefined. Okay? So that's how you do that. Let's see what happens to the other quadrantal values. If I want, let's say, the cosine of, let's say, -9 pi/2, okay? I want the cosine of -9 pi/2. Really, we just want to figure out, this is over 2, so we know it either here or here, right? Up or down. So we want to know, is it up or down on the unit circle? I mean, on the positive y or on the negative y axis. Okay, so the same thing, you just convert -9/2 to an improper, to a mixed number rather, so you get -4.5, right? That means to say, you are at -4 pi, Now negative 4 being even, so you're here, right? That's negative 4 pi. And then you subtract pi over 2, right? So when you subtract, you go clockwise, right? So you go clockwise, so you go down, all right? So I guess we go down here, and there is your negative 9 pi over 2, okay? And so therefore, if we want the cosine, let's look here. This is 0, negative 1. So the cosine is going to be 0, okay? So it's just a counting game, okay? And you have to just know how to convert your improper fraction into a mixed number and make sure you know how to do the counting, okay? Negative means clockwise and positive means counterclockwise. And remember that here you have the odd multiples of pi, here you have the even multiples of pi. And I think it should be fine, all right? Okay, another thing that you might be asked is, let's say you're given the value, let's say sine of theta, let's say is equal to negative half, and you're asked to produce all the values of theta, or s if it's an arc length, okay? Let's say in the interval 0 to 2 pi, so one complete circle, okay? So then using this chart, you know that sine is the y coordinate, so you know that your answer has to deal with pi over 6, right? A multiple of pi over 6. So you know that this has to be pi over 6 something, right? But because, so we know this. So we're looking at the half, right? But because sine is negative, that means to say we know that it cannot be pi over 6. It has to be multiple of pi over 6 down here, right? Okay, and that multiple of pi over 6 is either there or there, right? And I told you, if you know the first quadrant, this is the reference angle or arc business, right? So this one, because that's pi, this angle has to be, or arc, has to be pi plus pi over 6. And this one has to be 2 pi minus pi over 6. So hopefully you follow. We have to be in the third or fourth quadrant, right? Because sine is negative. And if you solve for this is going to be 7 pi over 6 is one answer. And the other answer is 11 pi over 6. Okay? So, and these two are in this interval. So you have to check what interval I'm asking. Okay? So look the shikir for this kind of interval. And then make sure you do your appropriate multiples. And this is your, again, this is your friend here, that if you know this is theta, right? Either the angle or the arc, the dog. Okay, so then this is going to be pi minus theta, this is going to be pi plus theta, and this one is 2 pi minus theta. So make sure you know these, and then you can find the other multiples according to this chart, okay? Well, I know this is not your favorite, but yeah, we have applications, and these are the formulas you need to know for your test on Tuesday, okay? First formula is S equals R theta. This gives you the relationship among the arc length S, the radius R, and the angle theta. In all of these, theta will have to be in radians, not degrees, okay? So make sure you convert all your degree measures to radian measure, okay? So area of a sector is given by the formula half R squared theta, okay? So you just need to know R and the theta. Angular speed is the rate of change of the angle theta with respect to time. Linear speed v is equal to the rate of change of the arc length with respect to time. And then if you put these two formulas, this one over here, right? So if you put s equals r theta here, you will see the relationship that linear speed is equal to the radius times the angular velocity, okay? So these are the five formulas, and I know you get scared of your word problems, but once you read a word problem, just remember on our test, we're doing circles, okay? So when you see the word problem or something, you draw your circle and you figure out, did she give me the radius? Did she give me the diameter? Maybe I'll trick you and give you the diameter, okay? Do I know the central angle? Do I know the arc? What do I know and what do I need to find, okay? But if you know these, you should be fine, okay? So just draw your circle, your radius, your central angle, and I think you'll be able to figure this out, okay? And of course, before you come on Tuesday, make sure you have a clear picture of the six graphs, okay, the basic graphs. So I drew here sine and cosecant together, okay? So these are reciprocal functions, so we remember how we drew them. So sine, this is the sine wave. The way I remember it is it starts at 0, 0, okay? And then I just put my 5 points and I go to 1. And remember, I explained how you can look at the unit circle in order to generate these points, okay? And then cosecant being the reciprocal, so these broken lines are the asymptotes, right? When sine is 0, of course, you don't have cosecant value, so then you have the asymptotes, okay? So that's how you graph your cosecant. Similarly, for cosine and secant, so cosine starts at 0, 1. Sorry, the neighbors are noisy, okay? 0, 1, and then you go like this. It's a wave, okay? And then to draw the secant graph, yeah, I would always start with cosine first and then draw the secant graph, the reciprocal, so they go like this, okay? And these are the asymptotes, all right? So, and tangent. Tangent graph looks like this. This is the basic tangent graph. This is the basic cotangent graph, all right? So, yeah, for sine and cosine, what are the important things you need to pay attention to? So, I already taught you how to shift them and stuff like that, so make sure you review those, okay? For sine or cosine, they have amplitudes, right? Okay, so the height of the wave, okay? And possibly a good question I could ask is, what is the lowest point on the graph? What's the lowest value of the graph, okay? Or the function, what's the highest value of the graph? Or the function, the highest point on the graph or the maximum value of the function? So things like that, okay? So make sure you're able to answer when you shift these things around. Maybe what's the range, okay? From what to what, all right? Notice that sine and cosine, the domain is all of the reals. There's nothing undefined, right? So asymptotes don't play a role for sine and cosine. But for the four others, you would be interested in asymptotes. That means to say, probably I'll ask you, find the domain of this, okay? And make sure you know how to, you know, remove those asymptotes, all right? So, yeah, and then there will be some questions where I won't even require you to graph, just based on the equation or the given equation of the function, you know, like, can you figure out what its amplitude is, what its period is, okay? What's the phase shift, and so on and so forth, okay? So, maybe I'll give an example of that. Okay, sorry, it's very noisy. Okay, let's say I have this problem. Find the maximum value of y equals 3 minus 7 sine of the argument is 2x minus 5, okay? So, we know that the sine values are sandwiched between negative 1 and 1 without these decorations here, right? Okay, so that's how we will start. We know that the sine of any angle or arc will always be sandwiched in between negative 1 and 1, okay? So then we know the effect of this is to make the amplitude bigger, right? Higher, okay, or larger. So then we can actually do this. So then we can just multiply across the board by negative 7. Now remember that when you multiply by a negative number, the inequality will switch, right? So you'll have this, okay? So you'll have this, and then I guess you just add 3 to everybody, okay, to get the form that you want. And so you get what? Negative 7 plus 3 is negative 4, all right? So if you actually write this the correct way, negative 4 is the smallest value, so you can actually answer the question, what's the minimum value of the function, okay? And of course, the highest value now is 10. So this is the minimum value of the function, and that's the maximum value of the function, and we answered it without graphing. Of course, some of you, if you don't know how to do this, you can quickly draw a sketch, right? And do that without having to be fancy. All you're looking for here is, you know, the range, okay, the amplitude. If we were going to answer the question, what is the range of this function? So the range of this function, let me see, I'll put it here. So the range will be from the lowest to the highest. So that's going to be the interval, negative 4 to 10. So if you were to really draw this nicely, you will expect the graph, you know, from negative 4 here and all the way to 10 there, okay? And you'll have your sine wave. And yeah, you have to take care of shifts and everything. But this is the lowest point on the graph. Highest point on the graph is there, okay? So that's how you kind of analyze a piece of the big function, okay? Let's say I were to ask you, find the phase shift of the graph of y equals 3 minus 7 sine of the quantity 2x minus 5. So you know that normally your sine function starts at 0, 0, goes like that, right? Okay? This occurs when x is 0 and that's where you start. But now because we have 2x minus 5 is the new argument and not x, then all we have to do is set this equal to 0, right? And solve for x. So you get 2x is pi, x is positive pi over 2. So you say the answer to this is now phase shift is pi over 2 units to the right. Okay? Of course, if you have a positive there and you get negative, then you say it's pi over 2 to the left. Okay? So that's kind of like little questions you can answer without actually having to draw the graph full blown. Okay? What else can we answer here? Like I already pointed out that the number in front of the x, that multiplier there, will change the period, right? So if you were to look at the period of this, that's going to be 2 pi over 2, okay? It's absolute value. So that's, the period is pi, okay? So that means to say you will see two sine waves in the interval, well, in over a period, an interval that's 2 pi units in length. Okay, I cannot say 0 to 2 pi because there's a phase shift. Okay? And I guess that's it. That's about it. Is that all that we can answer for this? The amplitude, of course, has nothing to do with the 3. The amplitude is always the multiplier in front of the function. It's 7 times, so therefore the amplitude is positive 7. Okay? Alright, supposing I want you to find the zeros of the function y equals tangent of 3x minus 5, okay? One way you can answer this is if you know the graph. Asymptotes are here, right? Negative pi over 2, pi over 2, but the zeros occur where? So this is, let's say, 3 pi over 2, that's pi. So they occur at 0, at pi, at negative pi, at all integer multiples of pi, right? If you don't remember the graph, you can also use the unit circle. Tangent is sine over cosine. So sine over cosine, so y over x, right? So that happens when sine is 0, right? When the sine is 0. And sine is 0 here, 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 here. So those are integer multiples of pi. So in order to answer that question, you'll say, well, then 3x minus pi has to be n pi, where n is an integer, right? And all you do is solve for x. So you have 3x is equal to pi plus n pi. And I guess you get, yeah, you can actually combine these, okay? So this is going to be n plus 1 pi, where n is an integer. And then you can divide across the board by 3. So you have x is n plus 1 pi over 3, where n is an integer. And I suppose we can change this, but yeah, you can just leave your answer like this. If n is an integer, n plus 1 is also an integer. So you can replace n plus 1, let's say, by m. So multiples of pi over 3, where m is an integer. Okay? So that's how you solve something like that. Now, instead of zeros, let's say I change this and I say, find the asymptotes of the graph of y equals tangent of 3x minus pi. So now for asymptotes, you know that they occur at odd multiples of pi over 2, right? So negative 1 pi over 2, 1 pi over 2, 3 pi over 2, 5 pi over 2, okay? Or you can also, instead of, or if you forget this graph, you know that asymptotes will occur when, because tangent of theta is sine theta over cosine theta, right? You know that the asymptotes will occur when cosine is 0. Now where is cosine 0? If you forget the graph, you can always appeal to your unit circle. Cosine is 0 here, 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 right? And what are those? Those are odd multiples of pi over 2, right? Okay? Yeah, we can't have even multiples of pi over 2 because the 2 will cancel out, right? Okay, and we will end up here. So we want odd multiples of pi over 2. So our work here, let me get my... So then our work here will look like this. So now if we want the asymptotes, or another way I could phrase the question on your test is find the domain of the function, okay? And you'll see why these are related. So then you'll put here 2n plus 1. That's how you represent odd numbers, right? Pi over 2, where n is an integer, okay? And then you just solve for x, okay? So you'll have... Whoa, what happened? So you'll have 3x is equal to pi plus 2n plus 1 pi over 2. Okay, I guess it's not dry yet. Okay. And then we divide by 3 across the board or multiply by a third. So you'll have pi over 3 plus 2n plus 1. Pi over 6, right? When you multiply by a third, you get this. And then you just simplify this. You can put together the pi over 3 and the pi over 6. So you'll have pi over 3 plus pi over 6. 2n pi over 6 is really n pi over 3, okay? Where n is an integer. And then you just have to simplify pi over 3 plus pi over 6. I guess I multiply this by 2 over 2. You get 2 pi plus pi is 3 pi over 6. So you will get pi over 2 plus n pi over 3, where n is an integer. I hope I did not mess up. Yeah, the kids next door are noisy. But yeah, I just want to give you a quick review for your test. And I think that's about it. Okay, and I, you know, just go back to how we graph the transformations. And I think you should be in good shape if you know these things. Okay?